Special guest speak for tonight. It's a young man who hails from the Midlands, amen, but comes from, but now ministering over at Salford in Manchester. His name is Elder Andre Crawford. He'll be our speaker for tonight. I'll share more details about his work, his life, extraordinary background for an extraordinary speaker. So I pray you'll open your hearts and minds to receive his words tonight that comes from God himself. Before we go any further, let's just bow our head for a word of prayer. Father in heaven, thank you so much for sparing our lives one more time, for allowing us to be on this platform, Lord, to be used to understand how much you want to speak to us, to guide our minds to spiritual things. I pray every person on this platform may find something for their lives tonight. Whatever our needs may be, please, Heavenly Father, in your goodness, please supply. And when we have left this platform tonight, Father, may we leave with the reassurance that we have heard God speaking to us. We pray for our scripture reading person, Tamando, but also for our speaker tonight, Andre Crawford, Elder Andre Crawford, who will also open up your word. Use them both tonight, Lord, in a mighty way for your service. And when all is said and done, may all honor and glory and praise go to you and you alone. Be with us, guide us and lead us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
The scripture reading is taken from Acts 3, verse 6 to 10. It reads, "Then Peter said, Sovereign God, have I none, but such as I have given thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And he took him by the right hand and lifted him up, and immediately his feet and ankle bones received strength, and he leaping up stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. And all the people saw him walking and praising God, and they knew that it was he which sat for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple, and at that which had happened unto him. May the Lord bless the reading of his word. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Tamando, thank you for reading that scripture reading so eloquently and so well. And may God just bless what we've heard from our young scripture reading person tonight. Tamando, thank you so much, sir. As I mentioned to you earlier, our speaker tonight is Elder Andre Crawford, a man of God. And I pray that as he speaks to your hearts and minds tonight, you'll be truly blessed by what he's saying from God himself. Andre is a person from Birmingham and grew up at Smethwick Church before moving to West Bromwich Church. Then from there to Manchester, studying music at Salford University. And after completing his studies, he trained to be a missionary. In 2007, he attended the Arise School of Evangelism, which changed life completely. He then returned to England and began preaching and teaching the everlasting gospel. In 2014, he felt by prayer and conviction that he must work for God. And therefore, he became a full-time self-supporting minister. He left his job to work for God full-time. In 2019, he received a call to work for the North England Conference as an administrative tutor for the Peace School of Evangelism alongside Elder Craig Gooden and Elder Sam Walters. And then in 2020, last year, he had another call from God, and this time to be a Bible instructor in Area 2, District of Salford, Manchester North, Oldham, Old Trafford, and Moss Side. He currently serves in his capacity whilst he attends Salford Church. This is a man of God who's also served as a head elder of the church. He has been busy, but more importantly, he has responded to wherever God has sent him. He has taken a challenge and gone totally in faith. So it's my joy and heaven's joy to introduce to you tonight, Elder Andre Crawford. May God bless his words to you all. Amen.
We were working fine just before we went live. We went live and my computer just decided not to work. But we praise God that not even technology can stop the word from going forward. I just want to thank Mark and Simon for this invitation to speak to you. And, you know, I was thinking yesterday, I wonder what would have happened if the England and Germany game was tonight. But we praise God it was last night. Everyone's happy. But we're here to hear the word of God. As you can see, or as you've seen, the message is entitled, "Well, what did you expect?" is a question. Well, what did you expect? And our sermonic theme is taken from Acts chapter 3. So before we move on, we'll open with a word of prayer and then we'll jump straight into the text. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for this evening. We thank you for the time that you've given to us to pray and to study your scriptures. And I pray now, Lord, that as I open your word, that you'll be with me. Give me quickness of thought and make my lips loose. Help me to communicate the truth as you have given it to me. Open now our eyes, Lord, that we may see wondrous things out of your law. Is my prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So I hope you have your Bibles with you. We're going to start in Acts chapter 3 and verse 1. Acts chapter 3 and verse 1. Now, Luke, when he is setting up this whole scene, tells us, now Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer, being the ninth hour. Now, the hour of prayer, it's a prayer meeting. That's where we are. That's where the setting is. The prayer meeting, it's the ninth hour of the day. It's about 3 o'clock in the afternoon. And Luke wants us to understand that because there is something amazing that's going to happen at this time of prayer meeting. Before we move on, let's read a quote from Acts of the Apostles 57, paragraph 1. It says, I'm not sure what's going on with my computers today. Brothers and sisters, just pray, please pray, because I'm not sure what's happening with my all of my computers this evening. Yeah, it says, the disciples of Christ had a deep sense of their own inefficiency, and with humiliation and prayer, they joined their weakness to his strength, their ignorance to his wisdom, their unworthiness to his unrighteousness, their poverty to his exhaustless wealth. Thus strengthened and equipped, they hesitated not to press forward in the service of the Master. Now, what we want to understand is just prior to this verse, or just prior to this, this verse in Acts chapter 3 and verse 1, Peter and John had been in the upper room. They had heard the promise from Jesus that they were supposed to stay in Jerusalem and they would receive power. In Acts chapter 2, they receive that power and they go out preaching and teaching the word. And there then we find them in Acts chapter 3 and verse 1. And it says, it's prayer meeting, it's the third hour of the day. Verse 2, Acts chapter 3 and verse 2. And a certain man, lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple. Now, I want you to take notice of what we've just read in verse 2. There's a man who's been lame from his mother's womb. And in Acts chapter 4, we know that he's over 40 years old. He could be my age, 42. He's over 40 years old and he's been lame from his mother's womb. And the Bible says that he's carried daily to the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple. Now, a short time, Acts of the Apostles 57:2, a short time after the descent of the Holy Spirit, and immediately after the season of earnest prayer, Peter and John, going up to the temple to worship, saw at the Beautiful gate a cripple, 40 years of age, whose life from his birth had been one of pain and infirmity. She goes on to say, this unfortunate man had long desired to see Jesus, that he might be healed, but he was almost helpless and was far removed from the scene of the great physician's labors. His pleadings at last induced some of his friends to bear him to the gate of the temple. But upon arrival there, he found that the one whom his hopes were centered had been put to a cruel death. Now, that's a sad scene. The man had been disabled for 40 plus years. He'd heard about Jesus. He'd heard about the miracles that Jesus could do. He'd been brought daily to the gate of the temple. And getting there, he's expecting to see Jesus, only to be told that Jesus had been murdered. Only to be told that the one whom his hopes had centered was now dead. How sad and how demoralizing for him that he thinks, if I can only meet Jesus, then I can be healed. But then I've got some more questions. Why did this man on the door of the church only ever receive the things for the here and now? Because every day he goes and he asks alms, and every day he receives alms. But clearly he has a greater need than the money. He has a greater need than what was temporarily wrong with him. He had a need for healing. And each day he goes to the church multiple times a day. People are in and out, in and out. He'd gone there to see Jesus, but he'd found that Jesus was dead. But maybe, just maybe, those that were going to the church were going to be able to help him. But again, I ask the question, why did this man on the door of the church only ever receive the things for the here and now? Why had he never received the most important things? Why had he never received healing? Even though he was coming to the door of the church every single day, multiple times a day, people were going in and out. He never received that which was needful the most. Were the people that were going to the temple only ever comfortable and content at giving what was easy for them? Where was the sacrifice for the kingdom of God? Where was the sacrifice if they only gave from their surplus? Did they believe that their work stopped at, here's some money, I'll pray for you? So I want you to just think about that, because this man, Luke tells us, comes here every day. Comes here every day, and multiple times a day, people are going inside to prayer meeting, outside of from prayer meeting, but this man is still crippled. This man is still just receiving what he needs for the here and now. Why is it that they didn't have discernment to see, do you know what? This man needs healing. So Acts chapter 3 and verse 3. The Bible continues. In fact, let's read verse 2 again into verse 3. And a certain man, lame from his mother's womb, was carried, whom they laid daily at the gate of the temple, which is called Beautiful, to ask alms of them that entered into the temple. Who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked an alms. See, this man, on this particular day, is only doing what he's always done. This man was asking for alms because that's all he's ever received. He was only ever expecting to receive alms. Could it be that this man, the reason why he's asking for alms is that that's all he's ever been shown from the people that are going in and out of the temple? However, this day, Luke tells us that this crippled man is not just going to meet church members, he's going to meet disciples of Christ. So I can imagine that the man has his head bowed down, his arms outstretched, just asking for alms, just asking for that which was needful for his temporal condition, his temporal situation, hoping that his pleas would pull on the heartstrings of those that were going in and out of the temple. Let's keep going. Acts chapter 3, verse 3 and verse 4. Who, seeing Peter and John about to go into the temple, asked an alms. Verse 4. And Peter, fastening his eyes upon him with John, said, look on us. So the Bible says that Peter, after the man has possibly had his heads down and his arms outstretched, asking for alms, the Bible says, Peter says, look on us. So the inference is that the man wasn't looking at Peter and John. I hope you can see that. For Peter to say, look on us, infers that the man wasn't looking at them. And the Bible says that Peter, fastening his eyes upon him. So that word in the Greek is atenizo. It's to look with purpose. So Peter has fastened his eyes on this crippled man. He's fixed his gaze on this crippled man. He's looked on the crippled man with purpose. He's looked on the crippled man with intentionality. And this man now begins to understand that he's going to receive something other than what he's always received. So come with me to verse 5. The Bible says, and he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. So he's gone to the temple day after day. The church members have gone in, they've gone out, they've gone in at prayer meeting time, they've come out at prayer meeting time, and for all of these years, this man remains crippled. But this day, he's meeting not just church members, but disciples. And the disciples speak to him and said, and Peter says, look on us. They've looked at him with purpose, and they've looked on him with intentionality. And then the Bible says again in verse 5, and he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. What was it in Peter's voice that inspired the man to lift his head a little higher than his temporal situation? What was it in the three words that Peter spoke that encouraged this man to look a little higher? I want to put it to you that there was a wonderful intentionality in Peter's words. There was a tenacity of purpose in his tone, and there was a sizzling vitality in the voice of Peter, which caused the man to lift his head above his current position. Now, as modern day disciples, when we meet somebody, is there an intentionality in our voice that causes someone to look past their immediate situation? Is there a tenacity in our tone that says to someone, do you know what? Even though I'm experiencing what I'm experiencing, I'm expecting to get something a little more than what I need for the here and now. So again, verse 5, and he gave heed unto them, expecting to receive something of them. Verse 6, then Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I give thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. Now I want you to notice this. The man is asking for alms, he's asking for change. And when Peter says, look on us, Peter's first words are, silver and gold have I none. So in one sense, Peter and John were just as poor as the man who was asking for help. Hope you caught that. In one sense, Peter and John were just as poor as the man who was asking them for help. They were as devoid of means as this man was, but they were rich in something else. Devoid of silver and gold, but rich in something else. And in James chapter 2 and verse 5, the Bible says, hath God chosen the poor of this world rich in faith? So although Peter and John were poor in physical means, they were rich in faith. They were rich in faith. They were rich in the experience that they had had with Christ. They were rich in the knowledge that the one whom they were disciples of had been given all power in heaven and on earth, and that he had commissioned them to go, and that he was going to be with them all the way. And they believed it. They didn't just recite those words. They believed that wherever they went, the power of God was going to go. So although they're looking at this man's temporal situation, they could see past his temporal situation and see that he needed something much greater than what he was asking for. In Acts chapter 4, actually, when the leaders of the temple ask Peter and John, whose name and by what power do you do these things? Peter and John say, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. And in 1 John chapter 1, verse 1 through to verse 3, John says, we're not talking about things that we've not experienced. We're not talking about a Christ who we've never seen. But we're talking about someone who we've seen, who we've heard, who our hands have touched, who we've handled. So when Peter and John are fixing their eyes on this man and looking past his temporal situation, they knew exactly what they were saying. They were devoid of temporal means, but they were rich in faith. So Peter and John, they say, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, I give thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. Verse 7. And he took him. Now watch what happens here. He took him by the right hand and lifted him up. And immediately his feet and ankle bones receive strength. I want you to notice that Peter didn't just say a formula and then watch to see what would happen. Peter didn't just say, in the name of Jesus, rise up and walk, and then just see what would happen. Peter physically, personally, helped the man get to his feet. So let me go backwards. Peter is seeing past this man's temporal need. Peter recognizes that he is devoid of temporal means to sort out this man's temporal situation, but he's rich in faith. He's rich in experience with Christ. He's rich because he's experienced Christ. He's handled him. He's touched him. He's heard his words. And then he says to the man, based on his power, based on the promise that he is going to be with us, rise up and walk. But it doesn't stop there. The Bible says he took him by the right hand and lifted him up. Peter did not just say nice words. Peter didn't just say a formula, but he physically, personally helped this man get to his feet. Peter added his own faith to the faith of the man. And when faith is added to faith, miracles happen. When faith is added to faith, miracles happen. So again, Peter didn't just say, here's some money, let's see what God does for you. Peter commissioned him to stand on his feet and then helped him get to his feet. Personal ministry is more than just saying the right words. Personal ministry is more than just saying the right words. It's actually helping people get back on their feet. So when I was writing this sermon, my mind was cast back to all the times that I've met somebody on the street and they say, have you got any spare change? And all I've done is given them a pound coin, £2 if they're lucky that day. But that's it. That's where the conversation has stopped. And I dare say many of you are like that. Somebody's asked you for money or something and you've given them the money and then you've gone about your business. Or you've bought them the food that they've asked for and then you've gone. But the example of Peter here is personal ministry is doing more than what they're asking for. So again, Peter added his faith to the man's faith. And when faith is added to faith, miracles happen. Now, here's the miracle that I want you to see. After the man has received strength in his bones, and he's heard the words of the disciples. Watch what happens next. Verse 8. Acts chapter 3 and verse 8. And he, that's the lame man, leaping up stood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. I hope you saw the miracle. The man that was always on the outside of the church, when he has met disciples of Christ, he now ends up inside of the church with them and he has a testimony. Again, I hope you see that. The man who 40, he's been lame for 40 years. Let's just say he was there for 5 years. Every day he comes to the door of the church and every day all the members do is give him what is needed for his temporal situation. But this particular day, at the time of prayer meeting, he meets disciples. And the disciples see past his temporal need and give him that which was needful. That was healing. And then when he receives the healing, he's no longer on the outside of the building. He's on the inside of the building with the disciples. And now he has a testimony. What would happen if we took a little bit more time with the people who were asking us for money and we actually helped them get back on their feet? Maybe those people that we always see at Asda and always at Tesco and always at Sainsbury's and on the streets in the city centre, maybe if we took just one more minute to ask them how they are and help them get back on their feet, the next time we enter into Manchester Central or Salford Seventh-day Adventist Church or Wolverhampton Central, they're coming with us. The Bible says, and he, leaping, upstood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. It was because these disciples were willing to put their faith into action. They were willing to do a work of medical evangelism that got them the opportunity to bring a person who was destitute of money into the temple, into the church, so that this person now is amongst the group, amongst those that are in prayer meeting. And he has a testimony. In Acts of the Apostles, page 109, paragraph 1, Ellen White writes that all over the world, men and women are looking wistfully, longingly, hopefully to heaven. Prayers and tears and inquiries go up from souls longing for light, for grace, and for the Holy Spirit. Now listen to the last sentence. Many are on the verge of the kingdom, only waiting, or waiting only, to be gathered in. So many people that we meet from day to day are looking wistfully to heaven. We would never know that because we never hear that. Maybe they're praying in their minds, in their hearts, and every day we pass them, have you got any spare change, please? Yeah, here's a pound, I'll pray for you. But if we, like Peter and John, took a little bit more time, maybe those people would be sat next to us on this Zoom call listening to the word of God. It says, many are on the verge of the kingdom, only waiting, waiting only to be gathered in. Now, these next few verses is actually where the sermon title comes from. So let's read from verse 8 into verse 9 and into verse 10. And he, leaping, upstood and walked and entered with them into the temple, walking and leaping and praising God. Verse 9. And all the people saw him walking and praising God. The question that you need to ask is, all which people? And it's all the people that had passed him just a few moments before. It's those people that had passed him at the door that maybe gave him a bit of change and could just walk straight into prayer meeting. The Bible says, and all the people saw him walking and praising God. Now watch what Luke says. And they, that's the people, knew that it was he which sat for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. And they, the church members, were filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened unto him. Now I've got two questions. Church members, why are you so surprised? What did you expect? You've passed this man multiple times a day on the outside of the church, and you can see that he's lame, but you've only decided to give him alms. But you're going in to pray to a God who you say is all powerful, all knowing, all omniscient. And then you see this man walking into the church and you're surprised. But you claim to know a God who's all powerful. What did you expect to happen? These people who claim to know God and his limitless power, and that he can do anything and everything, are seeing this man, yet they're still surprised to see this lame man walking. Could it be that they had the form of godliness, but they were denying his power? They were going to prayer meeting every week, every day. They were going to church services every day. They were meeting people that had deeper issues than what they were expressing. Yeah, they were expressing, can you get me some food? Can you give me some money? But the members of the church, they just looked at this man and all they saw was his temporal need. But disciples of Christ see past that temporal need and see that there is a deeper longing of the heart. So could it be that these church members who had just gone into the temple day after day, week after week, church meeting after church meeting, prayer meeting after prayer meeting, they had the form of godliness, but they denied the power. So that when God actually does show up and performs a miracle of healing, they're amazed. Like, man, how did this happen? Verse 11. Let's read verse 10 again into verse 11. And they knew that it was he which sat for alms at the beautiful gate of the temple. And they were filled with wonder and amazement at that which had happened unto him. Verse 11, watch closely. And as the lame man, which was healed, held Peter and John, all the people ran together unto them in the porch that is called Solomon's, greatly wondering. Watch what has happened now. So the man that started on the outside of the church has received a work of medical missionary. He's now come into the church, and the disciples that have brought him in haven't just left him. The Bible says that the lame man held on to Peter and John. So they've brought him into the church, but they're continuing the journey with him. They haven't just taught him, baptized him, and then left him. They've performed the work of medical evangelism. He's come into the church, and they continue to hold him as he's making his journey. Now watch. There's something else in the text that I want you to see. And as the lame man, which was healed, held Peter and John, all the people ran together unto them in the porch that is called Solomon's, greatly wondering. So he starts off at the beautiful gate. He comes into the church, and now they're journeying to Solomon's porch. And he's continuing to hold those people that have brought him in to the church. Again, disciples of Christ adhere to Jesus's admonition. In Matthew chapter 28, verse 18 to 20, the Bible says, all power is given unto me in heaven and on earth. Go ye therefore into all the world and make disciples, or teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the world. Amen. So we are very good at teaching people and then getting them into the pool. But what we're not very good at is holding them, continuing to hold them like Peter and John on their journey. Because the Bible says that the healed man held on to Peter and John. And as they were traveling from the beautiful gate to Solomon's temple, all the church members are wondering, man, how has this happened? And my question again is, well, what did you expect? You serve a powerful God who can raise the dead. Healing a lame man is nothing. And then, verse 12. Peter says, seeing what has just taken place and seeing the amazement on the church member's face, Peter says, verse 12, and when Peter saw it, he answered unto the people, ye men of Israel, why marvel you at this? Or why look ye so earnestly on us, as though by our own power, or holiness, we had made this man to walk? Peter's like, why are you so surprised? You guys are acting like it was our own power that we're doing this. Remember, the narrative starts the ninth hour, which was the hour of prayer. So he's gone into the prayer meeting and he's saying, you guys were just praying to the all-powerful God. You've left and you've passed this lame man, and now he's in your midst and you're surprised? Peter again said, ye men of Israel, why marvel you at this? Or why look ye so earnestly on us, as though by our own power or holiness, we had made this man to walk? And when you read the rest of the chapter, what you find is that Peter has an opportunity to preach Christ. But that methodology is not new to Peter. Because you find that any time that Jesus took time with people, he was able to give them the gospel. Just think about it. Anytime Peter took more than just a passing notice or a passing glance at people, he was able to preach the gospel to them. And here we find in Acts chapter 3 that a work of medical evangelism, a work of medical missionaries, opened up an opportunity for Peter to preach Christ. In fact, let me go a little bit further. Not only did they preach Christ, but they preached prophecy. Because what they're preaching is that a fulfillment of prophecy. Because when you read the rest of the chapter, Peter says, listen, the power to do this work was from Christ. He was the one that came down from heaven, and he was the one that you guys rejected and you killed. So I want you to notice that a work of medical ministry, a work of medical missionaries, opens up an opportunity to preach Christ, and not only to preach Christ, but to preach a present truth message. Now, as I begin to wrap up the message, I want you to know that in this time, we have been told in 2021 that the same opportunities that were afforded Peter and John would be ours if we followed the same divine plan and divine method. In the book Evangelism, page 523, paragraph 3, Ellen White writes this. She says, I wish to tell you that soon there will be no work done in ministerial lines, but medical missionary work. So let me say that again. Evangelism, page 523, paragraph 3, Ellen White says, I wish to tell you that soon there will be no work done in ministerial lines, but medical missionary work. So the fact that we are having this Zoom is good, but if all we do, or if all we can do is preach and teach, then soon we're going to become redundant. Because soon we're going to get to a place that the only thing that we can do is what Peter and John done. And that's a work of medical evangelism. Why? Because people are going to be sick. People are going to need help. And before we can give them the message for this time, we're going to have to fix their temporal situation, which is the healing. We've seen so many people are switched onto the gospel now because of this pandemic that we're in. So many people are switched onto the gospel because of this pestilence that we're in. So I want to share another quote with you from Councils on Health 506, paragraph 1. Councils on Health 506, paragraph 1. Ellen White writes, as religious aggression subverts the liberties of our nation, those who would stand for freedom of conscience will be placed in unfavorable positions. Let me read that sentence again. As religious aggression subverts the liberties of our nations, those who would stand for freedom of conscience will be placed in unfavorable positions. I want to ask you the question, are your freedoms being curtailed right now? Can you see that sooner or later your religious liberties, your civil liberties are going to be curtailed? If you can, then there is a work for you to do now, because the quote continues. She says, for their own sake, they should, while they have opportunity, become intelligent in regard to disease, its causes, its prevention, and its cure. So let me read those two statements again, and then I'll continue the quote. As religious aggression subverts the liberties of our nation, those who would stand for freedom of conscience will be placed in unfavorable positions. For their own sake, while they have opportunity, and I would say lockdown is a great opportunity to learn some medical evangelism. They should, while they have opportunity, become intelligent in regards to disease, its causes, its prevention, and its cure. And those who do this will find a field of labor anywhere. There will be suffering ones, plenty of them, who will need our help, not only among those of our own faith, but largely among those who know not the truth. So, and here's the beauty of what has just taken place, what we're still in. Courses and trainings that you would have had to pay for and go abroad to learn are now online. Remember, we're told we need to become intelligent in regards to disease, in regards to its causes, its prevention and cure. So somebody comes to you and says, you know what, I've got a sore throat, I've got a cold. We should know that we are able to give them God's plan, or a remedy, a natural remedy that is going to heal the body without without damaging the delicate machinery. See, Ellen White tells us in Ministry of Healing, Simon, I don't have this quote for you, sorry. It's just come to my mind. Ministry of Healing, 127. Ellen White says, disease is an effort of nature to free the system from conditions that result from a violation of the laws of health. So if we understand which law of health has been violated, we're in a better place to help those people. So let's just say somebody is not drinking enough water and they come to you with a headache. Your first port of call isn't to go for aspirin, isn't to go for paracetamol. It's to ask them a question. How much water have you drunk? If they have, let's just say they're getting some flu-like symptoms. Our response isn't to go, let's get some paracetamol, whatever medication. Our first port of call should be, flu-like symptoms. What laws of health is it that they could have broken? And begin to dialogue with them. Remember, Peter and John had a conversation. The man asked them for alms. They gave him what was needful. So maybe we say, you're going to need some lemons, high in vitamin C, antiseptic, antibacterial. You're going to need some ginger because it heats the body. You're going to need some cayenne pepper because it's a vasodilator. It's going to dilate the blood vessels and get the blood flowing. You're going to need some pineapple juice because there's bromelain in there, which breaks down the outer wall of a bacteria so that all the properties in the lemon, the ginger, the garlic, all of those things can get inside of the cell. You're going to need to increase your water. All of those things should be going in our mind. And when you do that and the person becomes well from natural remedies, things that they have in their fridge, things that they have in their cupboard, they come to you and say, where did you get that knowledge from? Then you have an opportunity to give them the gospel, which they might not have been open to had you not treated their temporal need. So again, as we see that there are systems and laws are put in place, beginning to curtail our civil and religious liberties, what we should be doing is preparing. I don't have this quote for you either, Simon, I'm really sorry. Proverbs chapter 23, verse 2, I think it's 23:2. The wise man says, a prudent man foreseeth the evil and hideth himself, but the foolish pass on and are punished. Let me say that again. Proverbs 23:2. A prudent man foreseeth the evil and hideth himself, but the foolish pass on and are punished. Why have I brought that? Why have I quoted that? It's because when we begin to see certain movements take place, we are supposed to say, okay, I see that trouble is coming. Rather than wait for the trouble to come, I'm going to prepare myself so that when the trouble does come, I'm in a better place to be out of the way. But here's the thing that's going to happen. When people see your preparation, but they don't see the predicament, they're going to think you're crazy. When people see that you're making moves to get out of the city because you know, like Lot, Sodom is going to be destroyed, and people begin to see you making moves to go into a more rural setting where you can raise your own crops, where you'll be free from some of the distractions of the city, when they see those moves, but they don't see the trouble that's coming, they're going to think you're crazy. They thought Noah was crazy. They thought Abraham was crazy. They're going to think that you're crazy until the rain starts falling. So when somebody sees your predicament, when somebody sees your preparation, but does not see the predicament, they're going to think you're crazy. But if there's one thing that the pestilence has taught us in regards to a crisis, is that when there is a food crisis, Sainsbury's, Tesco, Morrison's, they can't help you. When there is a food crisis, they can't help you. So what we should be doing now is preparing, learning to grow our own food. Because just last year, if you could get food, you were rationed. Or you had to stand in long lines just to get food. See, don't let these situations that are taking place in our world pass you by. They are harbingers, they are warnings, they are messengers telling us that soon our Christ is going to come through those clouds. But before that, we have got to prepare for a crisis. And I like this quote, this saying. If you are not ready for the crisis, you are not ready for the Christ, because the crisis precedes the Christ. If you are not ready for the crisis, you are not ready for the Christ, because the crisis precedes the Christ. Final quote, Councils on Health, 506, paragraph 2. The shortness of time demands an energy that has not been aroused amongst those who claim to believe the present truth. There is need of personal religion, and that personal religion extends to personal ministry. Personal ministry is not a department in church. The operative word is personal. So personal ministry is the individual. So if a personal ministry department isn't doing personal ministry, that doesn't mean that you shouldn't do personal ministry. Just because you don't have the means to fulfill a temporal situation, that doesn't mean that you have nothing to give. There is need of personal religion, of repentance, of faith, and of love. I plead that there be a general awakening amongst us as a people. Let there be a constant watchfulness and unwearied prayer for the assistance of the Holy Spirit, and let us avail ourselves of all the help and light that God has given. We're told that there should be constant watchfulness and unwearied prayer. Jesus said exactly the same things to Peter, James, and John in Matthew 26, verse 41. When they were in the garden, on the verge, on the cusp of their trial, because a few hours later, Christ is going to be crucified and their faith is going to be shattered. He says to them, prior to that event, just prior to that event, on the verge of that crisis, he says, watch and pray that you enter not into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. Jesus was communicating to them and saying, listen, you believe mentally that you're going to be, that you're in a good place, that you're ready for what's coming. But I know that you, that trouble is greater in anticipation than in reality, but not so with the crisis ahead. That's actually Ellen White, A Great Controversy. Trouble is greater in anticipation than in reality, but not so with the crisis ahead. I remember, as I'm closing, just to illustrate that point, I remember when I was younger, when I was a child, and I'd done something wrong, and the school would phone my mum, and they would tell me, we've informed your mum what's going to happen, what you've done. I would know that there was some kind of retribution coming at the hands of my mother. Now, if what I'd done took place in the morning, I would have the whole school day to fret about it. And then, because my school day finished before my mum's work day, I would walk home and it would be on my mind. I'd get home and I'd be like, why? It's 4 o'clock. It's 4:30. It's 5 o'clock. Mum finishes work. It's going to take her half an hour. And you're just watching the clock, watching the clock, watching the clock. And the mental anguish of the beating that's coming just wrapped the brain. And then mum came. We had a little discussion and she administered the punishment, which lasted seconds. But that all of that mental anguish was worse than the actual event. But Ellen White tells us, not so with the crisis ahead of us. We cannot imagine what it's going to be like. And I'm not telling you to scare you. I'm telling you that as in Psalm 91, if we have our place under the Almighty's wings, verse 10, only with our eyes shall we see the reward of the wicked. 1,000 shall fall at our side and 10,000 at our right hand, but it shall not come nigh us. So we have opportunity now to prepare ourselves to be evangelists when it all goes crazy. We have opportunity to be like Peter and John, that although somebody looks at us and says, can I have some change? We can look past their temporal need and say, do you know what? I'm just as poor as you are, but I can give you something that is much greater than money. I can give you something that is going to sustain you, not just for now, not just for tomorrow, but all the way until the coming of Christ. And maybe, just maybe, that person will end up sitting next to you, listening to a message like this one. That is personal ministry. Not just saying a formula, but actually helping people get back on their feet. So we're the message is finished. I pray we have some technical difficulties at the beginning, but I believe that the Holy Spirit has been with us and he's spoken to the heart and he's spoken to the mind, and he's ready and able and willing to do for us that which he did for Peter and John and this lame man. So I pray that this message has energized you. I pray that it's given you a focus. I pray that it's filled you up this Wednesday prayer meeting. And I'm looking forward to hearing the testimonies. If they happen for me, I'll come back and tell you. But I pray that we will see ourselves as watchmen, as light bearers, as medical missionaries for the gospel of Christ in these last days. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the word that you've given to us. Your word, although written thousands of years ago, is still pregnant with power. And we thank you that we can read a narrative in your scriptures and make modern day application. Dear Father in heaven, I pray that you will make us like Peter and John. Help us not just to see the temporal needs of the people around us, but help us to look deeper. Help us to take that extra time, Lord. If it means being late for prayer meeting, just so that we can minister to someone else. If it means being late on a Sabbath morning, so we can help somebody get back to their feet. Lord, help us not to pass those opportunities by. I thank you for the platform of Zoom and for YouTube and for all the different various platforms that you've allowed us for the gospel to go to the airwaves. Dear Father, I pray that you'll bless those that are listening live and those that will listen on the restream. We thank you for your son, Jesus Christ, and we accept his sacrifice. We accept his perfect life, and we accept the promise, and we claim the promise that he has given, that all power has been given to him in heaven and in earth, and he is with us even to the end of the world. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Well, Elder Andre Crawford, despite the initial technical difficulties, that God definitely plugged you in and utilized you in a mighty, mighty way. For me, I'm sure for those listening on as well, that was a manual for personal ministries. And I should be playing it over and over again. Some great thoughts, some great spiritual lessons, some great practical lessons for us to be utilized in these final days. So may God bless you in your ministry. You're doing a great work for God. You have been called by God. You're giving your job for God. But God has brought you for a time as this. And before we all leave, Andre also has a ministry. I'm going to find the part on it here very quick before we leave. And get the details for you here. And it's called Crisis Talks Ministry. Crisis Talks Ministry. It's www.crisistalksministry.co.uk. Tap into that website. It's about hope and health and healing, and it may cover some of what I'm just talking about tonight, but it's a great ministry that he's putting forward. God called him to. So it's www.crisistalksministry.co.uk. It's a tool given to him to give to us for us to help people in the world to know God practically and spiritually. So, Elder Crawford, thank you so much. I have been totally blessed. I've really been sitting down here pondering and thinking, yes, I've got to change, make some changes. And we pray that you'll come back shortly. You'll hear our testimonies, and we'll hear your testimonies to all being well. May God bless and keep you in what you're doing for him. God bless you forever until you see him face to face. Thank you so much.
Praise God.
Amen. As our custom is, after our prayer meeting session on the streamer below, you'll see a section on there talking about the prayer meeting after service. So those of you who want to come together for prayer on the Zoom platform, the details are now on your screen, then please join us. Let's pray together. There is power in prayer. We can testify of that. And if ever this church needs to pray, it is in these last days. So God bless you for being with us tonight. May God keep you. Let's have one more prayer before we close down on this part of the platform, and we'll see you on the other side. Let's just pray. Father, again, thank you so much for the way in which you, Pastor Andre Crawford, Lord, tonight for your service. Lord, we pray that we'll be people who not only hear the word, but do the word. Grant us the power, help us to name it and claim it. We can do great things for you. So we now give ourselves back to you, for you to use us. Tell somebody somewhere how great and wonderful you are. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you all. See you afterwards on the Zoom prayer session. If not then, we'll see you all again Sabbath morning for our divine service and our Sabbath school program. And this week is with our children. Our children are in charge of the platform for Sabbath school. And then our special guest from Nottingham Church will be doing our divine service program. So it'll be a fantastic, a beautiful Sabbath day experience. So please join us now and join us then on Sabbath all being well. God bless you. God keep you until that day. Good night.
God is able. God is able. God is able, and he won't fail. God is able. God is able. God is able, and he won't fail. Tell me who can make a mountain move out of my way, and who can make a miracle because of my faith. And when the doctor says no, who can still say yes? And when I'm in trouble, who's right there to help me pass every test? God is able. God is able. God is able. That the sun can look at me, and who can tell the wind to whistle through the trees? And when I'm in trouble, who's that same God that will come down and rescue me? God is able. God is God. He'll never leave, never forsake. No, he won't fail.